Luke chapter 13. Last week we ended with the narrow door. Jesus telling people to enter by the narrow door, and of course we said that that doesn't mean that God makes it very difficult for people to get to heaven. We're in Luke chapter 13. That's okay. Pay attention. I only said it like 10 times. Yep, I know. Okay. Where's my ruler so I can tap you? Yep, pay attention. So we talked about the narrow door and how, you know, this again is all tied into this overall narrative where we're called to die for the gospel. It's a selfless gospel, and it's because of love, and it's because we love people and we love God first and foremost that we give our lives up for each other, for one another. So Jesus tells us, you know, you need to deny yourself, pick up your cross daily, and follow me. And so all of these stories are tied into that, and Jesus also predicting that he's going to die, he's going to be buried, and he's going to overcome death. So these stories are not like these little individual stories that Luke just kind of, you know, gathers and puts together. There's a bigger narrative that Luke is weaving throughout the entire gospel. So, to enter by the narrow door, we just talked about how that means, Tex, can you pull those doors closed, please? Can you pull those doors closed? So, to enter by the narrow door just means that, you know, we don't know when Christ is going to come back. So, you need to be ready, and don't be surprised. Everything that we do needs to be in preparation for our death, for going to heaven, and bringing other people with us. So then we're gonna pick up in verse 31, chapter 13. I'm gonna read the rest of chapter 13. At that very hour, some Pharisees came and said to him, "Get away from here, for Herod wants to kill you." And he said to them, "Go and tell that fox, 'Behold, I cast out demons and perform cures today and tomorrow, and the third day I finish my course. Nevertheless, I must go on my way today and tomorrow and the day following, for it cannot be that a prophet should perish away from Jerusalem. O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to it. How often would I have gathered your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, and you would not. Behold, your house is forsaken. And I tell you, you will not see me until you say, 'Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.'" Okay, so Jesus is lamenting over Jerusalem. Jerusalem, of course, is it's the epicenter of religious activity. It's where God chose to have his name. It's where the temple was built. Jerusalem is where all the Jewish people, regardless of where you lived, three times a year they were required to come into Jerusalem and to celebrate these feasts. And so these Pharisees come, Jesus is in Jerusalem, and their message is, you got to get out of here. You need to leave. Herod wants to kill you. Now what we don't know is, were the Pharisees just saying this? Where did Herod really want to kill them, and Herod sent these Pharisees? Or were they trying to set a trap and see how Jesus would respond? Or did they just want to get rid of him? And because the Pharisees didn't really have a good reputation with Jesus for the most part. And so were they just trying to get rid of him and trick him into thinking that Herod was coming after him? We don't really know. But I would assume there probably was some validity to this, because Jesus never calls them on a lie. And I think he probably would have called their bluff. But instead, Jesus, he laments. He weeps. And so I kind of make the assumption that at this point the Pharisees are already plotting with Herod, because his lament is over Jerusalem for rejecting its prophets and killing its prophets. And so there is some responsibility that Jesus puts on the shoulders of the Pharisees. Because, that's kind of an interesting response to them saying, you got to get out of here because Herod wants to kill you. Jesus comes back and brings it on the shoulders of who? The Jewish people. Mm-hmm. Sure, yeah. 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 That's an interesting. Yeah. Very well could be. Yeah. That's a very good. A very good possibility. Yeah. 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 Yeah, I mean it's really impossible to know. We don't know, but it's kind of interesting to think about that. You know, were they allies? Very possible. Were they people who are plotting with Herod? Also possible. We don't really know. But, it doesn't much matter because Jesus' lament is over Jerusalem as a whole. You know, you reject the prophets that come in, and, well, go ahead and then I'll. Oh, no, not at all. Yeah. I think the bigger point is, I think a lot of people just assume that, but yeah, certainly not the case. Yeah, there are a lot of Pharisees that were allies, that certainly Jesus got along with. They got along with him. A lot of disciples were Pharisees. But Jesus' point here is not who has blood on their hands, Herod or, a certain group of Pharisees. Jesus' point is, I'm in Jerusalem. I'm in the absolute religious epicenter for Judaism. And you guys are rejecting prophet after prophet and putting them to death. And, you go back through the prophets and look at the history of God's prophets being killed by whom? Their fellow Jews. And Jesus laments over that. But I like that his message is sending back to Herod, you go tell that fox. And that's kind of interesting. He doesn't say wolf. Jesus often used the wolf metaphor. A wolf is somebody who masquerades, right, as a sheep. Well, foxes don't masquerade. They're just cunning and they're sly. And they are what they are. They don't pretend to be something that they're not, like the wolf does. No, that's right. Yeah, yeah. So, and he doesn't pretend to be a Jew. Herod is who he is. But he's also underhanded. And so Jesus says, you go back and tell that fox, behold, I cast out demons and perform cures today and tomorrow, and the third day I finish my course. I think Jesus is doing a couple things here. One of the things is in antiquity, they would talk this kind of language that was common in their day to just mean, you know, the present time. So they would talk about three days out. It was just kind of an idiom that they used to mean, okay, right now I'm doing this. I think probably, I don't think it's too much of a stretch, but I think, you know, it's quite possible Jesus is alluding to his death, burial, and resurrection. You know, the 3 days that he's gonna rise, because he says the third day I finish my course. Well, you know, I really think he's doing a couple things with this. But he says, nevertheless, I must go on my way today and tomorrow and the day following, for it cannot be that a prophet should perish away from Jerusalem. So what he's saying is, you know, the prophets are they're always brought back to Jerusalem, and they're killed here. You know, the very place where there should be peace, where there should be proclamation, where there should be worship, where there should be absolute unity. And that's the place where they come back and they're killing their prophets who are instructing them for the way of life. And it's just ironic. Counterproductive. Yeah, absolutely. Well, I think too, you know, fast forward to modern day, because this isn't anything new. The church is the one place where people who are the most oppressed, not depressed, oppressed, people who've come under oppression for whatever reason, they feel least safe in the church. And why is that? Well, it's because the church is abusive to the abused. And so we have all these, you know, twisted constructs of the gospel. And so we tell them things like, well, you know, you're just holding on to bitterness. You just haven't forgiven the man. And the volume of people who I hear about and who tell me personally that they're required to not only remain married to an abusive spouse, an abusive husband, but they're also required to not talk about it, to just shut their mouth and keep being beaten and abused. And I'm like, this is we're doing what the prophets were doing in this day. We're literally allowing people to be beaten and tortured and killed in the name of Jesus. And so, you know, I think the religious people who are killing the prophets in Jerusalem thought they were doing right. You know, don't misunderstand and think that they were just evil and, you know, they had it out for them. I think they genuinely, legitimately, in their own twisted minds, thought that they were doing what was right. And that's why Jesus is saying, you know, he goes on and he's like, you know, Jerusalem, Jerusalem. Verse 34, the city that kills its prophets and stones those who are sent to it. How often would I have gathered your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, and you would not. What's he saying? Yeah. 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 And Jesus, often in the Gospels, Jesus looks on the crowd and he has compassion. And the Lord, you remember when the Lord passed before Moses? He hides Moses in the rock, and it's just this crazy scene where God passes by him and shields his eyes, and Moses is allowed to see just the back of God as he passes by. And God reveals himself in that moment. And then you find it all throughout Scripture. The Lord, slow to anger and abounding in what? Yeah, love and compassion. The Lord is compassionate. That is his nature. That's who God is. God is not this God of wrath who just wants to wipe out mankind. Now, the foundation of God is justice and righteousness. And then steadfast love goes ever before him. Psalm 89:14. That's God's foundation. It's justice, righteousness and justice. Doing what's right, using fair and balanced scales. God never tips a scale in the direction of somebody. He uses balanced scales for everybody. God issues justice in relation to his righteousness. That word for righteousness in that passage means a balanced scale. God is fair. God is balanced. God will give you what is owed you. And then his steadfast love goes ever before him. So God is this compassionate God. And Jesus sees these crowds and he says what? The 5,000, which really was probably more like 20-some thousand, because it was 5,000 men. Jesus exhausted, hungry, and they crossed the lake to get away from the crowds because the crowds were pressing in so much that they couldn't eat or sleep. They go to the other side of the lake, and before they even land, they see this massive crowd. I mean, tens of thousands of people. And what does the Bible record? Not just that he spoke to them. Jesus looked on them as sheep without a shepherd and had compassion on the crowd. I love that passage. And so this is exactly what Luke is talking about in this passage. You know, Jesus is compassionate. He says, I would have gathered them as a hen gathers her brood under her wing. I would have cared for them and taken care of them and protected them and shielded them, but you would not. And of all places, here in Jerusalem. So then verse 35, behold, your house is forsaken, and I tell you, you will not see me until you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Now, what in the world does that mean? He's quoting Psalm 118:26. What does he mean? You will not see me until you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Anybody know where Psalm 118:26 is quoted again? Yeah, the triumphal entry, Luke 19. Luke 19, Jesus comes in. In fact, if you want to jump over there, Luke 19, we'll start in verse 36. Luke 19:36, and as he rode along, they spread their cloaks on the road. As he was drawing near, already on the way down the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of his disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they had seen, saying, blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. That's Psalm 118:26. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. So Jesus is saying, you know, the next time you'll see me, you're not going to see me until you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. See, you want the miracles, you want all the good things that come, but you mistreat your prophets and you put them to death. And it's sad. It's sad today. It's just as sad today. And I think Jesus is weeping over his church who mistreats people who have been mistreated. I think he's weeping. And so I think the good news is that the church has ample opportunity to be the hands and the feet of Jesus, to do exactly what Jesus did. Now, does that mean we're going to have these great, big, successful churches? No. Jesus, for the most part of his 3-year ministry, was on the run because people wanted to kill him. It wasn't like this fluffy, nice, peaceful, singing kumbaya around the fire at night, you know, the camp songs, and, you know, and they're having like these campsite baptisms because people are just emotionally moved at, you know, at how wonderful the Lord is and all the blessings in their life. Look at who Jesus had coming to him. The sick, the lame, the downtrodden, the poor, the oppressed. Just Jesus was constantly exhausted. Jesus often withdrew to what? To pray. Jesus often withdrew to lonely places to pray and to recover. And what if our ministry looked like that, where instead, see, we flip that. We flip that, and I think a lot of that is pop culture that guides that. But, you know, another part of that is just human nature. But we gauge our spiritual health by how well we're being fed. And it stands in stark contrast to the call of the gospel, which your faith is measured by what? How well you feed others. Are you taking care of others? Are you genuinely reaching out to them? Because it's not about us. It's not about our preferences and what we want, and, you know, having, not that we shouldn't have vibrant worship, but that's not the goal. The goal is what? Deny yourself, take up your cross daily, and follow Christ. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, and I think, absolutely. And I think, too, you know, on the third day I finished my course, I think he's sending a message back to Herod, whether Herod understood or not. But, yeah, you can kill me. It doesn't matter. And we talked the last couple weeks about mission. You know, Jesus was driven by mission. The mission is not going to be thwarted. It's not going to be stopped. It's not going to be derailed. Jesus has a mission, and that mission is going to be completed. And so it's not, you know, behold, I cast out demons and perform cures today and tomorrow. And on the third day, I can't do it anymore. That's not the message. The message is, I finish my course. And on the third day, my course is finished. You know, I accomplished my mission. And nobody's going to stop that. Nobody can stop that. And what if we understood the gravity of that? Because we get shut down so easily as Christians. Like, we got our feelings hurt. The one saying that I've come to hate, I'm offended. I don't care. You know, like, okay, we all get offended. So what? And I love the one comedian. I mentioned it here before, but the guy, he's like, I'm offended. So what? He's like, nothing happens to you. You don't wake up and you're like, oh, I'm offended. I've got leprosy. He's like, nothing happens when you're offended. Yeah, yeah. So his point is, I'm offended. So what? Deal with it. Yeah. Yeah. But even if somebody gives you reason to be offended, so what? You know, that doesn't change who we are. That doesn't change our mission. See, if we were mission-driven, it would not matter if people offended us. But see, when we get offended, what do? We've got to correct them. We've got to show them the error of their ways. We've got to show them how they were wrong. We've got to show them that they need to repent. You know, and we get rabidly obsessed as if the person who offended us is the one with the problem, which maybe they are, but it doesn't matter. Like, if we're driven by mission, do you think Paul was ever offended? I think a lot. Do you think the other disciple, do you think Paul ever offended anyone? Right? Like, but Paul didn't go around apologizing to people for offending them. And Jesus, I love this, when his disciples, because he's name calling some Pharisees, and then when his disciples come back privately, they're like, Lord, did you not know that you offended them? And Jesus like just starts name calling, and he's just like he intensifies his offensive language towards those Pharisees. And I love that, because Jesus isn't like, oh no, I better go make things right with my brothers. Jesus just like, so? Why? Because Jesus is driven by mission. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, John the Baptist. Do you think he offended anyone? You know, and the point is not that we need to go out and not care if we offend people. The point is, when you're driven by mission, you don't get caught up constantly with these little fights and these little battles, and you know that ends up consuming you. Yeah, yeah, absolutely. No, the message is for all of us. You know, be driven by mission, period. Know what your mission is that's been given by God and do it. Don't worry about who you offend. Somebody wrote me a nasty letter and they said that, you know, you have no business preaching and blah, blah, or whatever it is. So? Right? Not many people do that, though. I have, you know, I have a lot of friends who are in ministry, and I have people who they're uprooting their family and they're leaving churches because they keep getting offended. Well, we're butting heads with the elders and we just can't get along. Okay, so name a human that we don't get along with at some point. Like my wife, have we ever not gotten along? Absolutely. You know, there are times when you butt heads with people and that's okay. Like, sure, absolutely, yeah. Yeah, but when you're driven by mission, like you work on that, yes, but you're driven by, and you go. You're driven by mission, and none of that matters in the end. Okay, so we're going to move on, because I could stay on that forever. I know. Verse 14, chapter 14, verse 1. I got to ring that first bell. On the Sabbath, I love the ones that start with that, because you know people are getting offended. One Sabbath, when he went to dine at the house of a ruler of the Pharisees, they were watching him carefully. It's a little eerie, isn't it? Why are they watching him carefully? That's right, they're waiting for him to mess up. And behold, by the way, I'll throw a note in here. Legalism does this. Now, we think legalism creates this, where you watch people and you're waiting for them to mess up. Now, we think legalism, we automatically think fundamentalism, extreme right wing, you know, the further right you go, the more legalistic you get. My theory is, and I don't hear many people talk about this, but my theory is the farther to the right and to the left. In other words, the more extreme you are one way or the other, the more legalistic you are. Legalism is on both ends of that spectrum. So on the extremely conservative side, you have legalism that looks like this. You're like every single scripture is so literal that, like, I was reading this past week discussions on how people are going to hell if they have a kitchen in their church building. Like, that's still today. That was really hot back in the, like, 50s, 60s. That was really hot. But even today, oh, yeah, oh, absolutely. Yep. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Like, churches fight with each other and they disfellowship each other over having a kitchen in the building because the Bible doesn't mention kitchens in the Bible, so therefore it's an addition to the church and it's a sin.
But there's no
church. Exactly right. Exactly right. Exactly right. Yeah. Oh yeah. Mhm. Mhm. Yeah. So that's on the extreme right. Now, what does that look like on the extreme left? Well, if you don't accept everything, you know, and the irony, see, on the left, on the extreme left that preaches tolerance and acceptance of everyone, they're some of the most spiteful, hateful, unaccepting, intolerant people that I've ever seen, far more than people on the far right, I think. And it's just... Sure, yeah. But really, that's on both... I mean, it's on both ends of the spectrum. So if you don't... If you believe that kitchens in the building are acceptable, then you're a sinner, and we're going to force you out or kick you out or make you feel unwelcome. You know, and so it is both ends of that spectrum. It's this extreme legalism where unless you abide by all of these rules, you know, if you disagree on this side, if you disagree with, on the left side, if you disagree with, take abortion, if you're pro-life, then you hate women, and you're not for women's rights. Like, that's a pretty broad assumption. So it's just legalism on both ends. So these guys, they're extremely legalistic. They're watching them carefully. They're waiting for them to mess up. And behold, verse 2, there was a man before him who had dropsy. Dropsy is, it's a very painful, where your body fills up with fluid. You get fluid underneath the skin and all the cavities underneath your skin. Very, very excruciatingly painful. So I don't even know. I don't know what the treatment is today. I imagine they treat it with pills. I know you take a water pill. Like, we have pills that they basically make you pee a lot. Yeah. So it's basically forcing you to be dehydrated to get rid of fluid. So, you know, I don't know how we treat that specific disease, but yeah. Yeah. So, but needless to say, it's very painful and doesn't look pretty. So Jesus responded to the lawyers and the Pharisees saying, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath or not? Now, these are people who are extremely legalistic, and some of them are lawyers. So they're like legalistic to an extreme. And Jesus says, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath? That's an interesting question, because most of these Pharisees and lawyers are not going around healing people, I would imagine. Right. So Jesus asked that, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath or not? But they remained silent. Well, they remained silent because... Okay, kitchens aren't mentioned in the Bible. Healing is not specifically mentioned in the Old Testament, right? Under the rules of the Sabbath, and they're pretty extensive, healing people isn't specifically mentioned. So Jesus throws a wrench in the spokes, and they're like, what do we do with this? There's not anything in the Bible that says about healing on the Sabbath. And so they didn't know what to do with that. So they remained silent, and I love this. Then he took him and healed him and sent him away. Now, quick question. Why do you think Jesus sent the man away right after he heals him? Why do you think Jesus sends the man away after he heals him? Yeah, that's right. Jesus was protecting him. Don't stay here and worship. You get out of here. Jesus didn't, he wasn't like, okay, now let's sit and hear a word from the Lord. Jesus like, okay, you're healed. Get out of here. Go. Trust me. Run. So he's protecting the man. And then he said to them, that is the Pharisees and the lawyers, which of you having a son or an ox that has fallen into a well on Sabbath day will not immediately pull him out? Well, none of them. They all knew that if one of your animal falls into a pit, you pull it out. You're not in violation of the Sabbath if you pull an animal out. So how much more when you heal a human, somebody who's suffering? And they could not reply to these things. So I love these Sabbath passages because Jesus really messes with them. He's just shown he's not worried with offending people. Did Jesus offend people? He offended them to the point where they wanted to kill him. But Jesus was driven by what? He's driven by mission. What was his mission? To free the oppressed, to bring healing to people, and to preach the word of God. Was Jesus staying on mission? Yes. Was Jesus staying on mission regardless of the consequences? Yes. Did Jesus make exceptions for the mission? Never. It's hard to tell. Hard to tell chronologically because they... Yeah. Yeah. I'd say probably... My best guess would be this was in his last year of ministry. But it's hard to tell. All right. We'll stop there and...